running never did much good. Hiding doesn't last forever. You can't run faster when it's you you're running from. So you throw your hands up like doves to the setting sun. Somewhere down the stars are falling like jewels upon a thin black veil. You'll find the mysteries enthralling. 5 seconds seems like 5 billion years. 10,000 galaxies away, yet still so near.
Welcome to Karen Holton's podcast. Karen permanently lost 178 pounds and found happiness and success by following her own advice. She has now developed that advice into the quantum health transformation. Heal, evolve, and thrive. Karen's website offers a free webinar workshop series, and you'll also find tools, methods, and practices to assist you to become the change you want to see in the world. She believes that we are all connected. Heal the planet by healing yourself. Connect with Karen at her website, KarenHoltonHealthCoach.com, and through Facebook at Facebook.com/QuantumHealthTransformation. Now for the podcast.
Today, I'd like to talk a little bit about my journey as it played out with my body weight, the relationship, and how basically going from somebody who was chronically dieting, and because we were taught at the time reducing your calorie intake and doing a lot more exercise was the way to go. What happened was I would lose weight and then I would gain back usually more than what I had lost. And that just became kind of a cycle for me. And you can only stay hungry for so long. So, you know, there's some binging and some starving going on in there. And a lot of things that were not very good for my health. And undermined so much more. Even undermined my reason for being here on this planet at this time. And I want to take a look at some of these factors. So my top weight. And it's a guess again, because we don't like to get on the scales much once we're over 300 pounds. But I was wearing a size 48 and I weighed over 320 and my waist was about 56 inches in measurement. And there's a fair amount of suffering that goes on once a person gets that much weight on, because it severely affects every aspect of your life. So how did this happen? You know, I was the only overweight child in my family. Everyone else was thin and didn't have to deal with even thinking about what they ate. And I, who thought about it all the time, had the weight problem. So looking back at my life, I was a member of a very competitive family, also significantly dysfunctional. And that means that nobody had the tools to put together a healthy, healing family. And so there was a bit of chaos going on, amongst other things. Looking back on it, one thing that was very important was with both of my parents was that neither one of them could be challenged in any way. And if we did, there would be vindictiveness to catch up with us. And so it wasn't safe to be out and be bold and to be who we were. And so each one of us, there was 5 of us, myself and 4 siblings, we each adapted in our own way. Anyway, my way was to not compete with my mom over age and beauty. And so I think that is one of the reasons why I ended up becoming overweight, because then I was no threat to something that was very, very important to my mom, was that she be the trendsetter. She didn't go out in public unless she thought she was wowing people. And this was really, really important to her. And for me, coming from my perspective, well, it doesn't matter so much if I'm considered beautiful or not, you know, because to me, I was more into trying to be a better person, someone that I could live with, someone who I was proud of, because I was responsible for my own self-esteem. And so I was happy because I love my mother. I was happy to give that to her. I didn't realize, though, that it also set me up for a whole lot of other issues. But that's, I think, one contributing factor. There's many, many, many. Another contributing factor is I had issues with mood all my life. You could call it that, but you could also call it being awoke at an early age and been on the Ascension program my whole life. And so when you look out into the world and see what's going on, or even look within and see what's going on without proper connection to guides and to those that have been map makers before us, it's really scary and it can take many, many years to work our way out of that. For me, my answer response was to the shock and awe of what I saw that other people weren't seeing, was to believe what I was told, and that was that I suffered from, you know, mood disorder. I had problems with depression. When I was 14 is when they put me on benzodiazepines. I had a fair amount of significant trauma in my childhood. And so I had a lot of anxiety and stuff by the time I was in my early teens. And that was the solution of the medical industry. This is a long time ago. I was born in 1956. That's a long time ago. Things, you know, have changed, but in some ways they have not. This is meant to be universal and not an old lady's story about her life. So there was the whole diet thing that I already talked about. And I was very, very disciplined, very disciplined. And anyone who's been down that road knows exactly what I'm talking about. And now I eat what I really, really want. And that's it. There's no more issue. That's how much of a change in one lifetime can happen. Quite miraculous and yet very real for me. So anyway, other contributing factors was, like I was saying, I had, you know, depression. And so at an early age, I went on benzodiazepines on and off, right up until I was about 50. Part of my big awakening crisis was to come off all that stuff and really let myself wake up. And this is not an endorsement to do that. I'm just saying this is how it went for me. Anyway, in the 1980s, you know, they came out with a lot of antidepressants and SSRIs and stuff, and they caused massive weight gain. So understanding the medical industry and the pharmaceuticals and why I don't take pharmaceuticals is because they're all toxins. And when a toxin is introduced to the body, it's labeled as an obesogen. And by the way, many food-like substances, which are not food, not at that point, they've been so denatured that they don't qualify. They've lost their beautiful life force energy and the prime value that they had. Food-like substances, they may say, oh, it has this much vitamin A and D in it, but you can't believe that. Trust me. If you want more information about this, go and watch Food Matters and Hungry for Change and so many other videos. Oh, another really good one is called The Magic Pill. And that's another really good one, okay? Because that's beyond the scope of this podcast. These things are what they call obesogens. They actually will cause the body to hold on to create fat cells and store toxins in these little waste toxic areas that are protected through layers of membrane and fat, which are fat cells, and they keep them stored away from the central system so that the brain can think and the heart can pump and that you can survive. And this is a survival technique. So higher amounts of stress often add to weight. So there isn't just the stresses that society puts on us, but there's the stresses, the internal ones that we put on us as well, right? Again, related to my poor health due to these other things. I thought it was benevolent for me to do that for my mom, and then it just became ingrained in a habit. But also the consequences of what would have happened if I didn't do it, that was huge too. So, you know, I can't judge myself too harshly on any decisions I've made. It's all been for my greatest good and learning. These things are very, very important. And so it's almost like giving women barriers, being told what's expected of us, whether in words or in subtle messages and codes, or different kinds of pressures, you know, that we're supposed to look like something that we see regularly on TV and in commercials, but doesn't really reflect, you know, the true diversity of being human. why I'm saying that too is that because some people are bigger and some people are smaller, and that's just also how it is. There's that factor as well. But going over to epigenetics, we now know and scientifically been proven that we can actually have an influence on our genes by the way we think. Long story short, when I've had a few huge crises that helped bring me to where I'm at now, and so I don't know how I would have gotten here without them, so they must have been part of my plan, and I made it, and I'm so much stronger for it. I had issues where my soul, I guess my mind was not cooperating. Not I guess, I know that was the problem. I was just so brainwashed by religions and trying to fit into society and family brainwashing and dynamics and on and on and on, right? This is all I had to work with at the time. So my soul would intervene by connecting directly with my body and going, okay, we need something that's going to get her attention because she's not listening. And I believe illness is the same thing. So if I get a symptom and I go to the doctor with my symptom, he gives me a pill to get rid of the symptom, also introducing toxic waste into my body that my body's ill-prepared to handle. So another way of doing it is to take a look at the symptom and go, okay, what is this a warning or a message about? What is this? Why do I need to pay attention to this? What can I do? And then we start looking at what we're eating, and we start looking at the toxic levels of our lifestyle, and we start taking a look at a whole lot of other things. Well, back in the day, none of this was all crazy talk. To hell, today, this is all crazy talk. I live in Red Deer, Alberta, and majority of people who live here, I couldn't have this conversation with them. And they're not ignorant or stupid people. They're not well. Literally, a lifetime accumulation from all kinds of industry and stupidness that's not even their fault. And some of it is, but I'm not into talking about that. I'm into talking about how I can't have this conversation with the majority of people here. And I don't want to do it to them because it makes them feel terribly uncomfortable and frightened. And who am I to run around frightening my fellow human beings? I get told by my guides quite frequently, settle down, Karen, because you're going to disturb or upset Earth people. My message is not that weird to me, but some people who this is really, they've not been exposed to it. They don't have a context to it. They don't have someone they can go to and have honest conversation about it. Thank God YouTube and social media and different platforms are here to help us get the support we need, because we all need it. I need it. We all need it. Getting back to being a very large person, at one point after my son was born, they had just come out with large lady stores. One of them was called Pennington's, and I was in there shopping. And I tried everything on. This was a store that only had really big clothes for really big women who couldn't fit into regular sizes, okay? I tried on everything in the store, and there was nothing that fit me except a pair of bright yellow stirrup pants. And I'm going to post a picture in this podcast so they can have a look at those stirrup pants of mine. And my mom sewed me a t-shirt, took 2 meters of material to make me big poncho-style t-shirt because that's how big I was. I'm not making fun of myself, and I'm not putting myself down for talking about it. I'm just trying to give you the gist of my journey here so that you can understand how much it means to me to no longer have an eating problem or eating disorders or a weight problem, or I don't even own scales. And I am aware that my weight goes up and goes down, I would say give or take 20 pounds even over time, depending on the crisis, if my mom just died or relocating, or these things do affect my weight to a certain point. But always goes back to what my predetermined normal was, that I don't have to work for because it's my birthright. And that comes from detoxifying and doing a number of other things. And I would say the lowest on my list is exercise. That's something I need to work at. And I just go for lovely walks and do a bit of stretching. And I know how to manipulate energy while I'm stretching and while I'm walking too. So it's extremely replenishing what I do. But I don't kill myself with jogging and all of that jazz anymore. I don't do that. And I never go hungry. In fact, I actually sometimes have to keep an eye on how long it's been since I've eaten to just be able to feed my body and give it what it needs, because it's doing a good job for me. So there was other social things. When I was over 300 pounds, I could go to a party and go hang out with the guys, and I found the conversation way more interesting. The women were often venting about drama, and although I cared, I was obvious there was nothing I could do about it, and I would rather be out joking and hanging out, or if not with the guys, with the smokers, and sometimes that was the same thing. It's like going from a crowded party, house party, out into the back porch where it's cool in the evening and there's a few people out there, and you get into these awesome conversations, right? Little pods of people. It's very cool. But anyway, I fit into all of those because I was no threat because I was a big woman. It was just taken for granted I was no threat. And so what happened was when I lost weight, women were all of a sudden making stories that I was interested in their husbands. Well, I never was and I never would be. They complain about their men. God, who'd want them? No disrespect to the men, but that is, I'm just sharing what my reality was like throughout my middle of my young and middle of my life, right? And even a bit later. So anyway, I mean, that thought never even entered my mind, but all of a sudden, everyone was mad that I wasn't in the kitchen helping clean up and doing stuff, and not that I didn't want to help, but it's just the conversation was a real downer often. It was like all this stuff going on in the kitchen and people come and leave, and I just wasn't into that. I don't know why. I'm not saying I'm perfect, don't get me wrong. I'm just saying that's how it was for me. So anyway, that was very interesting. And the older I got, I guess men die younger than women, and women are more easily threatened. But I realized people are just threatened in general because the mainstream is such a narrow little band to be walking on. It's such a narrow. It's funny because we're told broad and spacious is the road leading off to destruction in some religious teachings, and the narrow and cramped is the road to enlightenment. But I have found that there's this narrow little band called the mainstream, and the more popular folks want to become within the mainstream, the narrower that band is. And it's tremendously crippling in many ways. Now, not everyone plays the game, but I'm just saying that this is the one you're introduced to until you find another one that you branch off to that suits you better. So weight is a tremendous get out of jail free card, at least it used to be, and for women. I think it's a different thing for men, and I think it's the last bastion of, I don't know if that's the right word, but that last area where it's considered okay to make fun of. And it's never okay to make fun of anybody or anything. And what's shocking is the different levels of empowerment that individuals are finding, and that I have found in the past, present, and future. So there's many reasons why weight is a solution. Maybe we live so feeling so cut off and isolated within our social reality that the only person who seems to care for us is the doctor, and so we go with all of our complaints because just to have 5 minutes of sympathy is something because it looks like he really cares. And often people in the medical industry do care. They just don't have a lot of broad spectrum information, let's just put it that way, to go on. Yeah, so then there's the physical aspects, the physical body pain from not detoxing, which also causes the weight, and the weight also causes more pain, and it's a bit of a vicious cycle. It's quite a chore to stay fit. You can, absolutely, but it's a big job. It's pretty much as much as a full-time job, another full-time job on top of your full-time job. Unless you're just, I know once you get to a certain point, you can keep it up easier, but without the nutritional support, that's really difficult to maintain. So I developed a lot of rules around food and a lot of phobias. And when it came time, my soul connected with my body, and I just couldn't eat certain things. I couldn't even conceive of eating them. And if I did eat them, I got very ill. Extreme anxiety, extreme bouts of even lust from some foods. I discovered that because I had been basically fasting, and I was over at somebody's house, and they were passing around these little frozen desserts that were just off the chart with probably artificial everything and very, very sweet. and I took a little bite, and it took seconds before I felt a response in my nether regions, which I did not expect. So food, like substances, do all kinds of things. They very much affect us biochemically, and it doesn't take long for it to work. And then again, it adds to the whole distraction scenario. So anyway, I couldn't eat those things because I was so shocked, in shock and awe by the response of everything I put in my mouth. And the less I put in my mouth, the more of a response I got. I also became very sensitive to electromagnetic frequencies. And this is all really common with the ascension process. And that's why I've put years of work into making podcasts and developing a website so that I could offer free information to people so they can go when they start having these symptoms and see what I did. That doesn't mean you should run out and do what I did. It means that you too can find your way the way I found mine. And I hope it encourages you to see that I have found my way. It's called Quantum Health Transformation. My website, Karen, K-A-R-E-N, Holton, H-O-L-T-O-N, healthcoach.com. And I've got a tab called Free Resources. There's oodles of information in there. Anyway, I became super allergic to chemicals. I found out that a lot of the way the universe works is by putting you at the right place and at the right time. And some would call it coincidences, but it happens so crazy often, there's just no way it can be coincidences anymore. So anyway, I found out that SLS, which stands for sodium lauryl sulfate or sodium lauryl sulfate or sulfite, people were getting migraine headaches from using shampoos with it in it. It's in lots of stuff, from hand sanitizers, shampoo, soaps, dishwashing soap, laundry soap, you name it. It's in a lot of things. Basically, it's like the world is filtering all the toxic waste through us, through our bodies, as a filtration system to help get rid of some of this horrible mess that every generation creates, thinking it knows what it's doing when it doesn't. Instead of eating humble pie and looking at how things are done in the natural world by the bugs and the flowers and the natural things, you know, we're just going to keep bumbling through this stuff. It just gets more technical, as in the case of 5G. So that's another podcast. So we're filtering this stuff. And so our bodies are loving us and we're producing fat cells. So between food-like substances, pharmaceuticals, our environment. And I got very, very sick. And I can't tell you, it was hell on earth. Not to mention going through over 35 years of Valium withdrawal and things like that. And I'll tell you, one of my things that really helped me a lot, and again, I'm not endorsing this or telling you you should do it, but this is what I did, was I used cannabis products. I learned to use them topically. I learned how to make my own medicine. I learned how to make edibles. I learned how to combine them with a healthy lifestyle. So that means not combining them with food-like substances and not combining them with a lot of other things. And it wasn't long after that that I started channeling, and I had an abundance of guides came to the fore. I mean, I was aware that I had sort of a guardian angel type thing going on over time. But the pharmaceuticals helped get rid of that because I thought that was part of mental illness. Didn't really understand what was going on. Anyway, as I detoxed, wow, the amount of internal resources was just unbelievable. I mean, it brought me to my knees in humility because I never could have imagined. It's not that all these stories out there and all these encouragements and quotes are not plentiful enough. They're plentiful enough. They're not getting through to us for some reason. Some of us, yeah, but maybe the Hindus are right. Maybe the suffering is the great gate opener. I don't know. Worked for me, but I would not recommend my path. It was pretty intense, and it still is at times, you know. Just for an example, just in the last couple of months, I had somebody in my family, very close and dear to me, gave birth to twins. And on the very same day, another family member, again, very close to me, committed suicide. And life is just full of these contrasts. And long story short, I know with me it's never short, but I try to make a series of short stories into my longer story. So that was what my weight was a response to what I was perceiving out in the world and reacting to what was out in the world. And once my internal environment shifted, once I started to detox, take responsibility for and shift, the other thing that happens is there's huge rewards, huge rewards. I mean, I never was one for salad. I wanted sweet and grease, that was what I wanted. And it wasn't until I detoxified that I found out what I really, really love. And I love foods that I call juicifying. Instead of drying out my mouth, they add moisture to my mouth. That's another whole podcast, my journey into rediscovering food and how it takes time once you shift what you're eating for you to intake those enzymes that then are like codes to the body that help you to then produce the other things you need to break down those very foods so that they become more delicious. And as we detox from overstressing our taste buds and our olfactory system, and we get back into a more serene level of stimulation in that area, what happens is it becomes very apparent what we need to feel better. And everything becomes so delicious that there's no way I would want to throw that off. It takes a while, two steps forward, one back, but there's no way I would want to throw off that incredible guidance system I have around food now. There are things that take me off my focus, stress and different things that I wasn't expecting to have happen. But it doesn't take long. The bounce back time gets shorter and shorter and shorter because you become master at your craft. Anyway, getting back to why I was overweight, because my environment was toxic. My physical environment was toxic. Everything I was putting on my body was toxic. Everything I was putting in my body was toxic. And what I was believing was toxic. What I was telling myself was toxic. What the world was telling me was toxic. And I was sick spiritually. And that's how my symptom was this huge vat of great suffering. I'm sorry, I don't mean to laugh at myself. It's not funny, but it's so different than my reality today. It's hard to even believe that was my real life. So you don't get caught up in the past negativity as much either with ascension because you learn the lesson, you let it go. You learn the lesson, you let it go. There's no need to rehash negatively influence memories only to put them away and take them out and deal with them again. There's no need for that. I know with certain kinds of post-traumatic stress that happens a lot, but there are ways to get around that, through that, and out of that too. Anyway, that's another podcast. So that's all I want to say for now is just I really wanted to get across to you that it's so much more than food. And also, we provide huge amounts of money for other people, when we have a toxic lifestyle, when we don't question healing modalities and we just take the pills because they're quick. Well, that's kind of like cutting off the nose to spite the face when it comes to us. And the other thing I really want to say in closing is that all of us have a hugely valuable, valuable, valuable thing to give this world. And this is your chance. This is your little blink of reality through the stream of infinity. This is your chance to do something amazing, amazing. You don't have to become anything different. You just need to take a look at what's holding you back. And just go, I want it different. Just desire it to be different. And it comes. And I'm so proud of all of you. I see so many people. By the way, I am not at the top of the Ascension program. Hell no. I'm just working my way through it like everybody else. But I wanted to contribute. I wanted to put some of my stuff out there so that y'all can see that if I can do it, maybe you can do it too. Or share this with someone if you think it would be helpful to them. And just remember, you're so not alone. Oh my God, if you only knew. And hopefully, if you listen to my podcast, it'll start to become real for you. And if it's already real for you, I'm so proud of you. Oh my God, what an adventure. Okay, signing off. Love you so much.
Lying only makes you hurt. Denying only makes it worse.
Love and surrender seem the fastest way to bring an end to bitter, painful days. Somewhere John, the stars are falling like jewels upon a thin black veil. And you will thrill to hear your calling. 5 seconds seems like 5 billion years. 10,000 galaxies away, yet still so near.